get going. So I don't know if you guys listen to any other preachers, but that's kind of the best that I do. I love listening to other guys. And I heard a great story from Andy Stanley. So Andy Stanley was one of my favorite guys, and he talked about his niece that was just a little girl, and she was on a swim team. And this girl was on a swim team for 3 years, and every single time, every event that she was in, she got the same place every single time. Not first, not second, not third. She got last place in every single event. And Andy said, the funny thing is, my sister and brother-in-law, they are very, very competitive. And it was just killing them on the inside that their little girl, but she had tons of friends. It was like a social gathering for her. She would be on these swim teams, and she just had a ball, and it never bothered her that she got last place every single time. So the mom was talking to her wizard, and year number four, do you want to be on the, oh, I want to be on the swim team. I want to be on the swim team. So the first meet that they had, the first swim team, what they would do is we wanted to be fans on the kids' arm, a marker, so that they know whatever that thing is called, that they go to the waiting station or that spot, so whether they can call that race in the room, that they take them on spaces. The mom is running the event on the girl's arm, so that she can which is why everything you got in life, really, to anybody that you have it with you, and you never know who might even this race. And also, your God is the one who 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 is was in a race. And so she just was doing a backstroke and just having a good old time. So we've got the Ten Commandments. And I think that's what sometimes is what we do, is we do a little bit of this swim race thing. But the Ten Commandments, oh, thou shalt not, or here it goes. At least that's the way that I took it whenever I was a kid. I learned thou shalt not, and that just meant I was in trouble because I was always in trouble as a kid. Of course I broke one of those commandments. It happened all the time. And I was nervous. I was fearful. God seemed big and strong. And when you look at Exodus, it's incredible. There's all these plagues. God appears in these magnificent ways. And so it just made me scared. And I was like, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. And I just kind of didn't get it. So last Sunday, it's a swim meet, swim race. Last Sunday, Pastor Jeff Ingle did a wonderful explanation trying to remind us that the Ten Commandments are not these codes or restrictions to beat us down. There were these beautiful laws that were put in place so that we would have a great, loving relationship with God and with one another. Because how can you have a really strong relationship with God? Those first four commandments, or the God, no idols, no visuals, no defense, except. How are you going to have a strong relationship with God if you break all of those? How are you going to have a strong relationship with one another if I'm always in? How can you have a strong relationship if you just have family dedication? How are mom and dad going to have a good relationship with the kids if the kids never honor the parents? How are you going to have a good relationship with somebody else when they're constantly lying to you? They are destroying the fabric of trust in that relationship since it's a relationship with God. There's nothing there because I know I can't trust them. That's what these are. These are basically these guidelines. I want to say guidelines for these commandments that are given so that you and I can have a great relationship and also that us and God that we can have a great relationship. Because if the kids are able to pull down to, we all have this thing that we have a good idea of what life would be like for us. At least we did with our parents. How many of you said, I'm not going to do what my parents did to me over some little petty thing or some serious thing? I'm not going to do what my parents did. Well, my parents said, my parents did. One of my words, I'm not going to ever tell my kids because I said so. you know what is one of my favorite things to say to my kids right now? I love this season because daddies, whenever I was a kid, there were certain words that we were not allowed to say at our house. Because we all have our moral code or moral compass, if you will. At our house, we can say, and I'll spell them because I don't want to offend everybody. A vacuum sweeper, S-U-C-K-S. A vacuum sweeper will do that. We can say that at my house as a kid, but my buddy Josh, if we're ever seeing this, I remember the time when Rice said that at his house. His mom just really gave me the mom that blessed. I was like, what would I do? And I didn't know that I had an effective her because I said something that was inappropriate at her house. I couldn't say that at her house. But guess what Josh could say anytime at his house? But if he said that at my house, he would be given the death threat from my mom. Or if he said there was support, so this is good things. There were things that he could not say. And so at my house, we had our own moral code. At Peter's house, we had our moral code. Over at Roland's house, Roland was like, there's on and on and on it goes because we all have this idea, this understanding of there are right things to do and there are wrong things to do. And so we make these rules, we make these codes so that we can have those good relationships, so we don't mess up the relationship. I remember the first time my kid went out to the road, Eli, our oldest, we had this it was real steep, but we had this driveway that sloped down, and he was just getting into running, and he started running down the driveway, and he ended up going out into the street, and I don't even think we're going out, but this, the oldest, so I just give him this place, good kid, to make it good kid, I'm there, and I stood in my mind, I didn't give him a spot on the behind, I was trying to get him. Because it's scared that they want to be parents have a kid run out the street that's what's scared that they want to be. Oh my goodness, you'll do whatever it takes to scare them so that they won't ever do that again. We make rules. We make our own laws. We make our own commitments in our own homes because we believe this is what's going to keep us safe and this is what's going to best provide a great relationship between us. And God understands this as the people come back to Jesus. They're now wondering for their desert, and they're all coming up with their own code, they're all coming up with their own rules. Now, someone has to come up with the almighty code of conduct or the moral compass for them. And because of God goes ahead and does that for them, and he listens to what Pastor Jeff said this. So God in his infinite wisdom realizes the people of God need a code. They need a system by which they can be governed. This code is for their good, it's for a wonderful life. And at the same time, it's about you. Because when you break those latter six codes between one another, all of a sudden there's no longer unity between you and that person. Because that will cause hell not to kill. First of all, you can be rested in and of itself. But anyway, self is one. And so we want to keep that unity together. So God gives us these commands. Last week, we did the first command, which is about worshiping the wrong God. And now we're going to look at the second command about worshiping God, the wrong one. So here's an ad. Here's what John Piper says. Remember, you have one life. That's all. You were made for God. So therefore, do not waste it. And calling life and life to this, we were made with one life, and we all have been given this desire to worship something. And so God says, this is how you are not to worship. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. And we can just pause right there. Isn't that a lot of these verses? You shall not make it in this way, or that way, or that way. Because what they were doing, they were doing the kids and God. And God is now having the biggest, the baddest contest. Who's the biggest, who's the baddest, who's the greatest contest? That's the contest. Who's the better God? And God, the awesome all. But they're still bringing these things into the people of Israel. And so God has to be very specific about what they can or cannot do. He says, he shall not bow down to them or serve them. Both those are in the context of worship. You shall not worship them under any circumstances. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God. That's not jealous because, oh, you've got the cool toy that I don't have. But you do everything. It's not because you've got some amazing gift or talent. That gift church of our talent is that he is just within his own words and for the difference with other people's words. This is the iniquity of the fathers on his children to the third and fourth generation. Holy spot in that house. He doesn't need our help. But we're so sad. we're supposed to have a good life. We're supposed to find his word, everybody's job. Because I want to do something in the world. Because faith is my life. If my life is over, I'm done. You guys, okay, God, I'm looking for this thing. It's a company by the co-pilot. But then whenever I'm done, I don't want you pilot it anymore. It is saying that this life, that this faith that I'm on, I want to be the director. I want to be the main lead. I want to do all these things. And then, God, I'm going to give you the definition of what you do. I'm going to give you your opportunity to die with this event. Thank you. pastor of this church. He's a tremendous guy. He had a lot of good things going on in his life, but Scott worked in the church. He worked in this church and he just went to the church. Completely changed. I'll never forget that I just saw the word that's amazing in our church. He came out of river. He came out of this hallway. He came out and saw me. He was just growing. Thank you. pray, God, that no more obedience out of fear, but that, God, it is our desire to obey you, because if God knew that we were not counting anything related to you, no more do we want to be in a relationship with you, we don't want to be in a relationship with God. Make these relationships more. So, God, it's not about thou shalt gods. I choose to follow, I choose to surrender, I choose to God. So, Lord, how I can be strong.